students, good morning. In yesterday's class, we completed structure of cilia and flagella. In today's lecture, we are going to start the very important cell organelle, okay, that is nucleus. Yes, as you all know that nucleus, it is a controlling unit, it is a brain of a cell which regulates all the activities of cell. So in today's class, we are going to study the detailed structure of nucleus, fine. So without wasting time, let's start the next cell organelle, that is nucleus. Fine, very important cell organelle. Now let's have some basic ideas, some general information related to nucleus, and then we will move toward its ultrastructure. Fine. Now we know that, or you might have learned in your previous standard, that nucleus was first time discovered by Robert Brown. Okay, so Robert Brown discovered nucleus, okay, in the year 1831 in orchid cell. Okay, so discovered by Robert Brown in 1831 in a cell of orchid root. Fine, in orchid root cell. So first time nucleus was observed, discovered by Robert Brown in the orchid cell. Yeah. Now if we see the number of nucleus, okay, per cell, so there is a variation in different number of species. Fine. So we will see how many nuclei could be present in cell. Okay? So the next point we will discuss, that is the number of nuclei. Okay? There are some cells in which nucleus it is absent. Such cells are known as enucleated cell. Okay, so the first condition, nucleus is absent, right? That condition, it is called as enucleate. Okay, there are some cells like mature mammalian RBCs, mature sieve tubes, okay, in these cells nucleus disappears, okay, once these cells mature. So such cells are known as enucleated cells. Okay, so examples, mature RBCs, mature sieve tubes. Yes, sir. So these are enucleated. We know that in case of RBCs, nucleus it is absent, so that most of this space will be available for hemoglobin, okay, and it can facilitate the transfer of oxygen. But for this, there are some exceptions. Huh? So these I am mentioning here. RBCs of camel and llama, they are nucleated. So this point you have to remember, RBCs of camel and llama are nucleated. Yes, mammalian RBCs are enucleated, nucleus is lost when cell matures, but there are some exceptions in which nucleus it is present. So such example, it is camel and llama. Okay, so camel and llama RBCs, they are nucleated, they have a single nucleus, so it is nucleated. Fine. Then in most of the cells there is only single nucleus, so that condition is called as uninucleate. So one nucleus is present, that is known as uninucleate. Okay, most of the cells are uninucleate whenever there are two nuclei. Okay, when cell consists of two nuclei, that condition is known as binucleate. Okay, naturally there are two nuclei, such type of cell it is known as binucleate cell. Example of this, it is paramecium. Okay, paramecium has two nuclei. Okay, it is known as micronucleus. and macronucleus. One nucleus is smaller, another is larger. So paramecia cells, they have two nuclei, micronucleus and macronucleus. Cells could consist of more than two nuclei also. That condition it is known as multinucleate. So when there are many nuclei, more than two, that condition is called as multinucleate. Okay, there are number of cells in which naturally multinucleate condition can occur. Multinucleate condition could be of two types. Okay, this word we have learned before also. That could be sinusitic. Multinucleate condition, it could rise because of sinusitic. Okay, or it could be syncytial. Or it could be syncytial. Syncytial condition. Just try to understand differences in two. What is mean by sinusitic and what is mean by syncytial. Sinusitic hyphae or cells are present in fungi. Okay. When you have learned the fungus part, in that you have seen that in some groups of fungi, hyphae it is sinusitic. So, sinusitic means multinucleate condition. When nucleus undergoes cell division, which is not followed by cell wall formation, that result into multinucleate condition. So, that is known as sinusitic. And syncytial means when the common wall between two cells, it dissolves. Okay? So, nuclei come to share the same cytoplasm and the same cell membrane cell wall. That also result in multinucleate condition. Okay, so in both the cases, cells are multinucleate. So example of sinusitic, in case of protist also, protist, fungi, okay, they have sinusitic cell and syncytial condition in animal cells, okay, mainly animal muscle cells, okay. Muscle cells are multinucleate cells. So these are the types of cell based on number of nuclei. So whenever there is one nucleus, that condition is known as uninucleate, two nuclei binucleate, and when there are many nuclei, that is known as multinucleate. Nuclei or nucleus, it is absent in mature RBCs as well as in mature sieve tubes. So that condition is known as enucleate. In case of RBCs, there are some exceptions in which nucleus it is present. So RBC of camel and RBC of llama, they have nucleus, so we call it as nucleated. Fine. This is about the number of nuclei. After this, we will see shape of nucleus. Nucleus, it is of different shape. There are different types of shapes. Okay, the shape of nucleus, it is not fixed. There is a variation in the shape. Okay, so let's see what different types of shapes it could have. Okay, the nucleus could be circular. Okay, it could be circular. Okay, it could be oval, nucleus could be circular, it could be oval, okay, it could be bilobed, okay, may have such a lobed structure, yes sir, it could be bilobed. Such type of nucleus it is found in acidophils, okay. Oval nucleus, it is usually present in smooth muscle cells. Okay. Nucleus could be trilobed. It may have three lobes. Okay. It could be trilobed like this. Okay. Example, basophils. In case of basophils, it could be multi-lobed, means when there are more than three lobes, that condition it is known as multi-lobed, again in one of the blood cell. That is basophils. Okay, it could be U-shaped or horseshoe-shaped. U-shaped, also known as horse shoe shaped, in a plant that is verticilla, slightly U shaped like this. Yes, example verticilla. Okay, so these are the different shapes of nuclei, but in most of the cells, okay, it is circular. Fine, there is a difference in the position. Okay, always it is not central, it could be shifted toward one side also. So it could be eccentric, it could be peripheral also. Fine. So if we see the location of nucleus, there is also difference in the in its position. So position of nucleus, okay, it could be centric in animal cell. It is centric, it is usually located at the center in case of animal cells. In animal cells, it is eccentric. In plant cells, okay, we have learned that in case of plant cell, there is a large central vacuole, and because of that, nucleus is shifted toward one side. Okay? So, in case of plant, nucleus it is shifted toward one side, that is known as eccentric. Okay? It could be peripheral in case of, it is peripheral in adipose cells. Peripheral in adipose cells. Okay, these are the fat storing cells of body. In this it is peripheral. Fine. Or it could be basal in case of columnar epithelium. Okay, or columnar cells. So whenever these cells, they are columnar, so in case of the columnar epithelium, nucleus it is located at its base. Yes sir, so the position of nucleus also varies from cell to cell. Fine, so these are the general things related to cell, okay, related to nucleus. Now we will move toward the structure, the ultrastructure of nucleus. You have to learn this thoroughly and note down all the things related to this, because that is a very important part. Number of questions can be asked on this. Okay, now let's see what are the different parts of nucleus. Okay, so structure of nucleus. Structure of nucleus. Right? Nucleus, it is a controlling unit, it is a cell, or it is a brain of cell. Why it is called as controlling unit? Because it has the genetic material which regulate all the activities of cell. Okay, so there are four different components or four parts of nucleus. Now the nucleus, as it is a cell organelle, it has double membrane system. So its envelope, it is double layer. So there are two membranes, there is outer membrane as well as there is inner membrane. These two membranes, they are separated by intermembranal space. Okay, just like our rest of the cell organelles, okay, nucleus has also envelope, okay, which is made up of two cell membranes, okay, or two membrane. The membrane of nucleus, it is known as nuclear membrane. Did you recall something? Presence of nuclear membrane is a characteristic feature of all eukaryotic cells. In case of prokaryotic cell, well-developed nucleus, it is absent. Fine. So this nuclear membrane, it encloses a cytoplasm or matrix-like substance that is known as nucleoplasm. Fine. So this is the outermost layer of nucleus. This is known as nuclear membrane. Fine. This is known as nuclear membrane. Okay. There is another name also, this is known as karyotheca. So nuclear membrane or karyotheca. Okay, karyon meaning nucleus, theca meaning outer layer. Okay, so it is also known as karyotheca. There are two membranes. There is the outer membrane and the inner membrane. So this is outer membrane and this one is inner membrane. Okay, these two membrane encloses a cavity that is known as perinuclear space. Okay, perinuclear space or intermembranous space. It is about 100 to 500 angstrom unit. Okay, its width is about 100 to 500 angstrom unit. Each membrane is about 60 to 90 angstrom unit in thickness. Okay, each membrane, not both the membranes. So while writing the notes, you just mentioned that each membrane has thickness of about 60 to 90 angstrom unit. A cavity enclosed by this membrane that is of a width 100 to 500 angstrom unit. Right? So this is the outermost layer which encloses the core of nucleus. Now, this nuclear membrane is not continuous. Okay, there are some pores or openings which are present throughout the nuclear surface. Just consider this nucleus as a ball. Okay, whatever we are studying now, that is from its one plane. So it is just a two-dimensional structure. Just consider it as a ball. So while considering the cell, you consider that there is a big sized balloon and inside that there is a small sized balloon. So that small sized balloon is nothing but the nucleus. If we cut the nucleus, we get a two-dimensional plane. So whatever structure we are studying now, it is its two-dimensional view. Fine. So the surface of nuclear membrane is not continuous. Okay, there are some gaps, so there are some holes, some pores. Okay, these pores are known as nuclear pores. At this place, membrane is discontinuous. Okay, so there are nuclear pores around 1000 to 10,000 nuclear pores are present throughout the surface of nucleus. Okay, they play a very important role. We will discuss their functions also. So these openings, these gaps which are present throughout the surface of nuclear membrane, they are known as nuclear pores. Okay, these pores or openings are known as nuclear pores. Fine. We are going to study the structure of this nuclear pore in detail also. These nuclear pores, they are about 1000 to 10,000 per nucleus. Okay, if we see its number, they may range in number from 1000 to 10,000, they are present throughout the surface. If we see its shape, they are octagonal in shape. Fine. Now, what is their function? Now, nuclear pore, they are involved in the exchange of materials between nucleus and the cytoplasm. See, from cytoplasm, everyone is not allowed to enter inside the nucleus because nucleus, it is a headquarter. It's not open to everyone. So cell will decide which substances will come and which substances from nucleus will go outside the cell. Very important, that is the mRNA. When we discussed the ribosomes, that time I gave you a general idea that how protein synthesis takes place. See, DNA is responsible for synthesis of proteins. Okay? DNA, it is a hereditary material. It codes for the sequence of amino acids to be present in different proteins. DNA forms its messenger RNA, mRNA, which acts as a postman. Fine. This mRNA carries message from DNA into the cytoplasm. I told you that process of transcription, that is process of formation of mRNA, it occurs inside the nucleus. Yes, DNA cannot move outside the nucleus. It has to be safe. It cannot expose itself to the harmful substances. So nucleus, it is well protected. DNA cannot come out of the nucleus. So it sends the message through a postman, that is the mRNA. So mRNA is formed inside the nucleus. That mRNA has to come out of nucleus for translation because ribosomes are present in cytoplasm. Ribosomes are much bigger in size. They cannot enter inside the nucleus. So through this nuclear pore, this mRNA, it comes inside the cytoplasm and then completes the process of protein synthesis. Along with this, some useful substances, amino acid, proteins are also required. So these substances can be taken in, okay, whichever substances are required, these substances. So these nuclear pore, they help in transport of materials in and out of nucleus. Fine. So these are known as nuclear. Now we will see the detailed structure of nuclear pore. Fine. This is the membrane. Okay. I'm drawing a little bit enlarged view of one nuclear pore. Okay. Suppose this is the membrane. Now this is the outer side of nucleus. This is the inner side of nucleus. We know that on outer side of nuclear membrane, ribosomes are attached. Fine. So suppose this is the outer layer. To this outer layer, ribosomes are attached. Ribosomes are attached to nuclear membrane as well as to the membrane of endoplasmic reticulum. So suppose this is the enlarged view of this much part. Okay, this much part of nuclear membrane we have enlarged. And now let's see the detailed structure of nuclear pore. So this is the outer side. Okay, this is the inner side. Okay, so inside of this there is a nucleoplasm. Fine. These nuclear pores, they are octagonal in shape. They are made up of 8 parallelly run fibers. Okay, so these nuclear pores, they are octagonal. Okay, I'm writing here, they are octagonal in shape. They are octagonal in shape and they are made up of 8 vertically parallelly running fibers. Okay, so made up of 8 vertical fibers. Made up of 8 vertebral fibers. Fine. Its diameter is about 800 angstrom unit. The diameter of each nuclear pore, it is about 800 angstrom unit. Fine. Now we will draw this structure. So there are, as it is circular, so these 8 vertically run fibers, they form an octagonal structure. So in this way, these 8 fibers, they are arranged and they form, okay, the octagonal structure which encloses a lumen. Fine. There is a narrow space, there is a small canal in between through these substances are moving. Fine. So nuclear pore, it is octagonal. Its ring-like structure, the upper ring-like structure which is formed, that is known as annulus. Okay, so this part, it is known as annulus. Annulus meaning a ring-like structure. Now just beneath the inner layer, there are some fibrillar structures, some fibrils or some fibrous material from nucleoplasm. They just come and arrange themselves just below the inner membrane to provide a kind of support. Fine. So that is known as fibrillar lamella. It is known as fibrillar lamella. Fibrillar lamina. Okay, this fibrillar lamella is rich in electron-rich proteins. Okay, it has electron-rich proteins. Okay, and they support the inner membrane. Support inner membrane. As on outer side, there are ribosomes. So outer side can be supported by number of ribosomes which are attached to it. So from the inner side, the fibrous material, fibers, they just go and get settled beneath the inner membrane. So they provide a kind of support to the inner membrane. Fine. So this is the structure. As I told you, there are 1000 to 10,000 nuclear pores per nucleus. So this is the outermost layer of nucleus. Fine. Now inside this, there is a cytoplasm like material. Just like cytoplasm, there is a matrix, there is a jelly like substance, fluid, semi-solid material that is known as nucleoplasm. It is also called as karyoplasm. Right? The membrane is known as karyotheca, and the cytoplasm of nucleus, it is known as karyoplasm. So this is called as nucleoplasm, also called as karyoplasm. Okay, number of substances are present in karyoplasm. We are going to study in details. Okay, it will take time, but it is essential to know each and everything related to nucleus. Fine. So the cytoplasm part, the matrix part of nucleus, it is known as karyoplasm. Okay, or so nucleoplasm. Fine. Now let's see what is present in this. The term nucleoplasm was first time used by Strasburger. Okay, term used by Strasburger in 1882. Okay, used by Strasburger. Number of substances are present in nucleoplasm. Now let's see what type of materials are present. Different types of enzymes, different types of proteins. Yes, they are found. Nucleic acid. Yes, all the things are present in it. So it consists of scaffold proteins. The scaffold means supportive. The scaffold proteins which are helping in the, you can say, accommodation or accommodation of DNA, or in case of the packaging of DNA, the help in the packaging of DNA. So present of scaffold proteins which organize higher order chromosome structure, which organize higher order chromosome structure. Now after this we are going to study the structure of chromosomes also. That time you will see how DNA takes the shape of chromosome, or what is the relation between this DNA and chromosome. As we all know that DNA, it is in the form of a thread. See here, this is very interesting part. DNA, it is in the form of thread, but at the time of cell division, that DNA takes the shape of chromosome. Why is it so? I will tell you a very simple example. If you have wool with you, that simple wool. If you lose that wool, and if it is separated, that you have a very big size or very big amount of wool, it's each and every thread, it is separated. If someone asks you to carry that wool from one place to the another place just by holding one string in hand, is it possible to move it from one place to another place? It may break in between. So if these threads, they are free, so many problems could occur while transferring them from one place to the another place. First of all, it will take more time. We need to provide more attention, because if it is very thin, if it is thread form, then it could break in between also. Genetic material, DNA, it is very important. Cell takes all the precautionary measure to prevent it from any type of damage. At the time of cell division, cell divides into two daughter cells. So that time DNA, it is transferred to the newly transmit or the newly formed cell. So if DNA is transferred in the thread form, okay, there is a risk of damage to the DNA. So that time what happened, the DNA condensed, DNA compressed, it condensed along with some proteins, and that DNA now act as a chromosome. So chromosomes are nothing but that is a highly condensed form of DNA. We are going to study how this DNA condenses to form chromosomes. Fine. So at the time of cell division, this DNA condenses into the chromosome. So when chromosome take their finest shape, okay, or the final shape that time, additional proteins are also required, supportive proteins are required. So such proteins are known as scaffold proteins, fine. These proteins are also present inside the nucleoplasm, fine. So scaffold proteins which organize a high order organization of chromosome. Okay, along with the scaffold protein, there are basic proteins. In nucleoplasm, acidic proteins are also present and basic proteins are also present. We will see what are the functions of acidic proteins as well as basic proteins. It consists of basic proteins. Okay, these basic proteins, they are rich in amino acids. Rich in amino acids like lysine, and arginine. Lysine and arginine. Okay. These proteins, they are associated with the packaging of DNA. Huh? Again, important point. Okay. I am giving you right now only introductory. In next class, we are going to study this part in detail. Fine. So, basic proteins, which are those proteins? These proteins, they help in packaging of DNA. Just now, I told you that this DNA undergo the process of condensation. So, for that, it needs a support. Okay. So, these are the basic proteins. We know that DNA, it is acidic, okay, it has a negative charge, so it can bind properly with the basic proteins, okay. So these basic proteins, they are rich in lysine and arginine. These two are the amino acids, fine. There are different types of basic proteins, yes, like H1, H2A, H2B, H3 and H4. Fine. There are five types of basic protein. These are known as histone proteins. Okay. There could be histone proteins. Okay. These are histone proteins. Okay. Histone proteins are those proteins which are associated with the packaging of DNA. Fine. Right now, this much information, it is enough. I am going to give its detailed idea in the next lecture, where we are going to study how DNA packaged into the well-formed chromosome. At that time, I will explain each and everything related to these histone proteins and all. Okay. So, in nucleoplasm, along with scaffold protein, there are basic proteins also. These basic proteins are very important because they help in the packaging of DNA. Cells are continuously preparing themselves for cell division. So, that time, DNA has to take shape of chromosome. DNA has to condense into chromosome. So, for that, these histone proteins are required. Five histone proteins are there: H1, H2A, H2B, H3 and H4. There is no specific rule behind this name. They are just on the basis of their isolation or discoveries, fine. So, H1, H2A, H2B, H3 and H4, right? So, these histone proteins are also present in nucleoplasm. The third group of proteins, these are known as acidic proteins, okay. Acidic proteins, these are also called as non-histone proteins. Acidic or non-histone proteins. Okay. Now these proteins, they are rich in some amino acids like tryptophan and tyrosine. Rich in amino acids, tryptophan and tyrosine. Tryptophan and tyrosine. Okay. So these are also helping the cell division. Okay. Along with this, these are also rich in. Okay. So these are the key groups of proteins which are found in nucleoplasm or the karyoplasm. Along with the different types of ions are also present. So I'll write this part over here. Along with this. Okay. So these proteins, they help in DNA replication, reparation. Fine. So along with this, there are some ions like magnesium, मैंगनीज, ओके. द पीएच ऑफ न्यूक्लियोप्लाज्म, न्यूक्लियोप्लाज्म इट इज स्लाइटली अल्कलाइन, ओके, स्लाइटली अल्कलाइन, इट इज स्लाइटली अल्कलाइन विथ अ पीएच ऑफ 7.4 प्लस और माइनस 2. Slightly alkaline. Along with this, all the enzymes which are necessary for protein synthesis, replication. Okay. So enzymes for DNA replication. Okay. Protein synthesis. DNA repair. So for these different types of enzymes are involved. So all these enzymes are also present in nucleoplasm. So you can say that nucleoplasm, it is the area where all the activities of nucleus are performed. Fine. So it include different types of proteins which help in the packaging of DNA into chromosomes. It has enzymes which are required for DNA replication, for protein synthesis, to repair the damage, okay, of DNA. Along with these different types of ions are also present. We know that magnesium, it is required for assembly of ribosomes, okay. Then manganese, it is the activator of several enzymes which are involved in DNA replication. Fine. So this is the second part. The first part we discussed, that is the nuclear membrane, karyotheca. The second part, nuclear pore. I'll just highlight this part because lot of things we have mentioned over here. Okay. So nuclear membrane, then nuclear pore, second part. Third part, that is nucleoplasm, also called as karyoplasm. Now the next structure which is present inside the nucleoplasm, there is a nucleolus. Okay, inside the nucleus also small nucleus like structure is present. Okay, so this is known as nucleolus. Okay, this is called as nucleolus. Its number could go from one to many, but not so many, not more than 10 usually. Okay, usually 2 to 5. Yes, sir. This is known as nucleolus. Along with nucleolus, there is the genetic material, that is DNA. Okay? So nucleic acid in a slightly condensed form, okay, that is known as chromatin. So this is the chromatin and that is the nucleolus. I'm going to write so many things for chromatin, so I'll rub all these things which we have mentioned for nuclear pore and nucleoplasm so that I will get some space. Okay, you just try to manage in your notebook. Okay, I'm keeping these names of parts. Fine. Now we have to focus mainly on the genetic material, that is chromatin. Okay, so that is the nucleolus. Okay, nucleolus, it is also known as little nucleus. Little nucleus or a ribosome factory. Okay, now why it is known as ribosome factory? Because it is a site of synthesis of rRNA. We know that ribosomes are made up of rRNA and proteins. So the major part, that is rRNA, are formed in the nucleolus. Okay, so ribosomes or these subunits of ribosomes are produced in the nucleolus. So it is also known as ribosome factory. Usually cells have only one nucleolus. Some cells may have many nucleoli also. Now this is known as the chromatin. Okay, chromatin fibers. Okay, these are क्रोमैटिन फाइबर्स. We are going to see lot of things related to chromatin fibers. So I need some space. I'll rub this part also. Now you have understood the parts of nuclear membrane. Okay. So that I can use this space. I'll just little transfer this name over here. Nuclear. Okay. So this red one which I have shown thread like structures, these are your chromatin fibers. Yes, now onward the part which we are going to see, it is very important. Okay, now let's see the structure of chromatin fibers. Okay, how it looks, what is their function, everything related to chromatin. Okay, now this chromatin, it is nothing but the DNA which has started its condensation. See, it is an interphasic nucleus. The next lesson which we are going to set is a cell division. That time you will understand all the details related to this, but this is a slightly condensed form of DNA. Now DNA or the cell has started preparing for the cell division. Okay, so these chromatin first time, or the term given by Fleming, term given by Fleming in 1879. As I told you, now this DNA is associated with histone proteins also. So let's see what is the chemical composition of chromatin. It has nearly 31% DNA, 2 to 5% RNA, about 36% histones or histone proteins, 36% histone proteins, 28% non-histone proteins. Okay, if we see the ratio of DNA is to protein, so it is nearly 1:1. Okay, so ratio of DNA is to protein, it is nearly 1:1. Okay, so nearly it is 1:1. Fine. Now we are going to study some important things with this chromatin. Okay, related with this chromatin. Fine. Now this chromatin, it could appear at two phases or it could appear in two stages. There are two types of chromatin. Now when we stain the nucleus, okay, with the help of some staining solutions, that time part of chromatin which appear darker in color, that part it is known as heterochromatin. There are two types of chromatin. When we stain the DNA, when we stain the nucleus, that time the part of chromatin which appears darker, okay, darker and thicker, okay, that part of chromatin is known as heterochromatin. Fine. So the region of chromatin which are thicker, which are darker, okay, that is known as heterochromatin. Whereas the region of chromatins which are light in color, they take very less amount of staining, or they get stained very little, so that lightly stained region, it is known as euchromatin. Fine, huh? So heterochromatin and euchromatin, these are two types of chromatin based on the stain. Along with this, there is a physiological difference also. Okay, we will discuss what is the difference in this euchromatin and heterochromatin. This is very important to understand this, because our other lessons like here genetics, cell division, all these lessons, molecular biology, all these lessons are based on this part. So the darkly stained region it is known as heterochromatin. Heterochromatin. Whereas lightly stained region, which is thinner, that is known as euchromatin. Okay, so heterochromatin and euchromatin. Heterochromatin and euchromatin. Fine, these are two parts of chromatin. We are going to study differences in heterochromatin as well as euchromatin also. I hope you have understood what is mean by heterochromatin and euchromatin. The darkly stained region, there are some stains. With the help of them, we can stain the nucleus so that we can observe its structure. So, a part of chromatin which appears darker, which appears thick, that region is known as heterochromatin. The another part of chromatin which takes very little stain, which is thinner, that is known as euchromatin. Fine. Now, let's see what are the differences in heterochromatin and euchromatin. Okay. Differences in heterochromatin. Heterochromatin. Okay, another side I will write the euchromatin. Okay, so differences in heterochromatin and euchromatin. So as I told you, heterochromatin, it is darkly stained area. So it is darkly stained region of chromatin. Darkly stained region of chromatin, whereas euchromatin, it is lightly stained region. It is a lightly stained region of chromatin. It is a lightly stained region of chromatin. Heterochromatin, it is much thicker. Okay, heterochromatin, it is much thicker. Okay. It is much thicker. It has a thickness of about 100 nanometer. Whereas euchromatin, it is thinner. It is narrower. It is narrower with a thickness of about 10 to 30 nanometer in diameter. Okay. It is very thin as compared to heterochromatin. Heterochromatin is much more thicker. Its diameter is nearly about 100 nanometer thickness. Whereas euchromatin is narrow. It is less thicker. Okay. It is thin. Thickness is about 10 to 30 nanometer. Okay. Next difference. Heterochromatin, it is a thick solid and condensed form. It is thick, solid and condensed, whereas euchromatin, it is thin and extended part. Thin and extended part. Okay, it is thin and extended part. Then if we consider with respect to metabolism, heterochromatin, it is metabolically less active, or we can say it is non-active, whereas euchromatin, it is a metabolically active. We will see what does it mean, what is mean by metabolically active or metabolically inert. So these are genetically less active, genetically or metabolically less active or inert, metabolically less active or inert, whereas euchromatin is genetically or metabolically more active, genetically more active. Now let's discuss what is the meaning of this. We know that DNA code for different types of proteins. Okay, there are some genes responsible for synthesis of protein. So these active genes, they are mainly present in the eukaryote or the euchromatin part. So we say that functional gene, active genes are present in euchromatin. Non-active genes, again, they are usually found in heterochromatin. We call them as functional DNA or junk DNA. The DNA we does not code for any type of protein. Okay, there are so many genes they don't have any type of function. Fine. So such genes are present in the heterochromatin. Euchromatin, it is a functionally active. all genes which are present in the part of euchromatin, they code for different types of proteins. So it is known as genetically more active. Fine. The next difference, heterochromatin has more histones. So histone proteins are more. Okay. Histone proteins only, we commonly call them as histones. So heterochromatin part, they have more histone, whereas euchromatin have less histones. Okay, more histones are present in heterochromatin. Obviously, if it is much more condensed, then it would have more amount of histone proteins. Euchromatin, it is less condensed, it is the extended part, thin part, so it has less number of histone. The next difference, heterochromatin replicate very late in S phase. Replicate late in S phase, whereas euchromatin replicate early in S phase. Early in S phase. Now S phase, it is one of the phase or duration in cell division. So obviously if the euchromatin, its genes are important, if they are going to form protein, that part of DNA has to be replicated first. It should form its duplica or replica first than the heterochromatin. These heterochromatins, they are not going to form the functional proteins. So that part cell keeps later. Okay, that part it is replicated later on. First functional DNA, functional genes are replicated properly, and then replication of heterochromatin begins. Fine. This euchromatin help, or it is involved in the formation of mRNA. Obviously mRNA, messenger RNA carries the message from DNA for the translation to form different types of protein. So this euchromatin DNA, it forms the mRNA, whereas rRNA and tRNA, they are formed from heterochromatin. So this DNA, it is formed, or it is used in the formation of rRNA as well as tRNA. Usually, whereas euchromatin mainly mRNA, it is formed from DNA. So the active DNA, okay, usually they form different types of mRNA, so that this mRNA could form different types of proteins. Okay, these are the differences. Now there are types of heterochromatin. Heterochromatin, it could be facultative or it could be constitutive. Okay, so we will discuss now what are the types of heterochromatin, what is its significance. Yes, so I hope you have understood it differences. I'll rub this part and I will mention here now types of heterochromatin. Very interesting part. See, student, genetic cell biology, it is a part of biology where you will not feel bored. Okay, so just pay your attention over here. Now let's discuss what are the types of heterochromatin. Types of heterochromatin. Okay, this heterochromatin is of two types. First one, constitutive, and second one, facultative. Constitutive and facultative heterochromatin, it could be constitutive heterochromatin or it could be facultative heterochromatin. Constitutive heterochromatin means in all types of cell there is some part of DNA which always remain in the heterochromatin stage, or you can say compulsory. Constitutive means compulsory, it is present in all types of cells. Right, so such type of heterochromatin, it is known as constitutive. And facultative means it is a conditional. It depends upon the cell. If cell wants, or if cell want to suppress the expression of particular gene, so it is required, or it is based on the requirements of cell. So it is present, or in some cell it is active, in some cell it is non-active. So that is known as facultative heterochromatin. So constitutive occurs in This type of heterochromatin occurs in all cells in all stages. In all stages. For example, centromeric DNA. Centromeric DNA. In your previous standards, you might have studied or you might have drawn such a structure of chromosome, at least basic structure of chromosome. This part of chromosome, it is known as centromere. Okay, this centromere, it is permanently heterochromatic. Okay, in all types of cells, okay, wherever centromere, obviously entire ribosome, it is nothing but the contains DNA. So this centromere, it is also consist of DNA, but this DNA does not code for any type of protein. So this is a permanently heterochromatic DNA in all types of cells at all stages. So such type of heterochromatin is known as constitutive heterochromatin, and facultative means it is present in only some cells. Okay, so occurs in some cells, okay, at some stages, not all stages, also at some stages of cell cycle, stages of cell cycle. Okay, so they are active for very less time. Okay, active for less time. Okay, its example, that is bar body. Okay, now again, this is a very interesting concept, bar body. Bar body means what? In case of females, okay, when there are two X chromosomes, we know that females are homogametic. Females have two X chromosomes. So out of these two X chromosomes, one X chromosome is heterochromatic for some time. Okay, so that is known as bar body, as this was observed first time by scientist Barr. So it is known as bar body. You can observe, so whenever we stain the cell, you can find a very fine structure attached to this nucleus, a dark structure. So out of two X chromosomes, one X chromosome is active, whereas another X chromosome, it is highly condensed, and it remain attached to the nuclear membrane. Okay, so for some duration it is non-active, and that is known as bar body. Okay, so this kind of structure, it is observed only in female cells. So this is this test, it is also used to differentiate between male cells and the female cells. If you take out some cells from male and some cells of the female, okay, so and if you stain the nucleus along with some stains, then you can find a dot or a dark color dot you can observe in the nucleus of females only. So that is a highly condensed X chromosome. Okay, this is just for the compensation of expression of genes. Okay, in males there is only one X chromosome, in female there are two X chromosomes. So to compensate the expression of gene, one chromosome, okay, become heterochromatic, it remains non-functional for some time. Okay, and that is known as bar body. So number of bar bodies in female, that is always number of X chromosome minus 1. Next year when we will see chromosomal abnormalities, some individuals may get abnormally more than one extra X chromosome also. Suppose there is a syndrome that is known as Klinefelter syndrome. In that syndrome, affected individual get XXY condition, means that person has 2X chromosome and 1Y chromosome. So out of 2X chromosome, 1X chromosome become bar body. Fine. In case of super female, that is when the condition it is XXX, XXX condition. Normal for normal functioning, only one X chromosome it is required. So whenever in normal woman there are two X chromosome, from that one remains active and one become heterochromatic. If there are three X chromosome, then from that two become non-functional. So in that case, we will get two bar bodies and one X chromosome will remain functional. So bar body, it is a facultative heterochromatin. Fine. So these are the types of heterochromatin. Okay. Now, at some places, heterochromatin form thicker bands. Now here at some places this heterochromatin become much more thicker, okay, than its normal shape. Okay, it is much more thicker and form dark and dense granules. These are known as karyosomes or false nuclei. So I'll label this karyosome or false nuclei. It appears like a nucleolus, but it is not actually nucleolus. Okay, it is just that in between some part of heterochromatin it is more thicker, and that is known as karyosome. Okay, thick, dark, dense granules. So these are thick, dark, dense granules on heterochromatin, present on heterochromatin. Fine. So this is about heterochromatin. Okay, huh? So whatever things we discuss, this is for chromatin. Yes, after nucleus, when we study the structure of chromosome, this part you have to remember. So just try to watch this video properly and mention all the things, and again revise also. And now the last part of nucleolus, or the last part of nucleus, that is nucleolus. So I'll rough this part. This is the nucleolus.